Hello and welcome to our second week in Isaiah 40. And our podcast today is on Isaiah chapter 40, verses 9 through 15. So we're our second stretch of verses in Isaiah chapter 40. We spent last week pretty much in 1 through 8. On Tuesday, we looked at the original meaning. And then on Friday, we looked at the kind of New Testament echoes of it. I think probably this week we'll be able to move on to a different stretch, verses 16 into the 20s on Friday, because I don't think that the New Testament engages these verses particularly. But let's go ahead and begin. Of course, those of you who like Handel's Messiah, I'm going to sing for you. O thou that tellest good tidings to Zion. Anyway. That's the verse that we begin with, verse 9. Yesterday, I looked at the Hebrew consonants of that passage on YouTube. And then on Thursday, I'm going to look a little bit at the grammar. A surprise looking at this that I hadn't realized before. So it begins, the Hebrew begins with verse 9, something like, unto a high mountain, get up you, get up y'all, except it's singular, get up you. The one telling good tidings, and then Zion. Now, the thing that's interesting here is the command, get up you, is addressed to a feminine singular, and the word one bringing good tidings is addressed to a feminine singular, and if you look at the video equivalent of this, you can see that these are feminine singulars, and guess what? Zion is feminine singular. And so it seems to me that the King James has got this wrong, and that in fact it's not saying, O thou that tellest good tidings to Zion, it's not to Zion. Zion is the feminine singular that is telling the good tidings. So it should be Zion. Get up, you, Zion, you who are telling good tidings, get up to a high mountain. Of course, Zion is a high mountain. So it's Zion is getting to where it's supposed to be. But of course, Zion has been in Babylon, right? Zion is returning from Babylon in a way. I'm not sure that I completely have what Isaiah is thinking here, but this is a possibility, it seems to me. It's a neat possibility, isn't it? Zion hasn't been home. Why? I haven't been home in decades. Zion hasn't been back to Zion into the high mountain that is the literal territory of Zion, the hill of Zion that the temple used to be on. Zion hasn't been in Zion, but Zion's coming home after 7 decades in Babylon. Zion's coming home. Okay, Zion, get up to your high mountain. Get up to where you belong, Zion. Get up, you who are telling the good tidings. And of course, as we're going to find out in a second, who are these good tidings being told to? They're being told to the cities of Judah, who are the surrounding territories. Now, maybe this is exegetical exploration here. Now, maybe somebody out there who's an actual expert on Isaiah will get on and shoot me down here. But I do think it's not the good tidings are not being told to Zion here. That's not what the grammar seems to be telling me. Zion is the one that is being addressed. Get up, you Zion, who are telling good tidings. And then it keeps going. Lift up, again, this command is to a feminine singular, with strength, your voice. This is a feminine singular, your voice, because Hebrew tells that the your is feminine. Hebrew tells this stuff. You who bring good tidings, same word, and then Jerusalem, which is feminine singular. So there's a parallelism here. O Zion, get you up into a high mountain, you telling the good news. O Jerusalem, lift up with strength your voice, you who tell good tidings. And then the next line, lift up. Don't be afraid. You know, I know you haven't spoken for a while, but don't be afraid. Say to the cities of Judah, and what do you say? This is so exciting. What do you say? Behold your God. Behold your God. Say unto the cities of Judah. Anyway, what is Zion saying? What is the good news that Zion is saying? What is the good news that Jerusalem is saying? It's, behold, your God, we're back. We're back. Yahweh is back. Yahweh is back in town. Yahweh is back in Jerusalem. Okay. And why did verse 9 only come up? Okay, those of you who are watching know that I don't have all my verses. So let me pull them up and we will go on with verse 10 here. Okay, verse 10. Behold, behold the Lord. Behold the Lord Yahweh, which is the proper name for God. When you see God in all capital letters like that, that's because it's Yahweh. When you see Lord in all capital letters, that's because it's translating Yahweh. The word Lord here is Adonai, which is the word for a Lord, as it were. Not the Lord is Yahweh. So behold the Lord your God. With a mighty hand, he will come with his arm. That idea of an outstretched arm, you know, is a theme, I believe, in the earlier parts of Isaiah. There is, by the way, a certain harmony in some of the imagery in the book of Isaiah. This is sometimes used as an argument for the unity of the authorship of all of Isaiah. But of course, an editor can bring that unity as well. See the patron video last week. Oh, unless you're a patron, you can't see it. Ha! Just kidding. I'm not really that evil. Ask my wife. No, don't ask my wife. Okay, so behold the Lord Yahweh with a mighty hand, with might, will come, and his arm will rule for him. Behold, see the repetition here. There's some parallelism going on. Behold, his reward is with him, is implied. His reward is with him, and his work is before him. Yahweh's about to do something here. Reminds me of Aladdin, where the genie kind of, okay, get ready, here we go. Of course, Yahweh's much more important than a genie. Okay, so forget that illustration. Okay, verse 11, like a shepherd, his flock he will feed. I think this is also in Handel's Messiah, but I don't remember it offhand what the tune is, so you're saved. Like a shepherd, he will feed his flock. With his arm, he will gather the lambs, and in his bosom, he will lift them up. The young, he will lead them. And so now we've shifted from the herald imagery, behold, the Lord is here, from the herald imagery to the shepherd imagery, which of course is elsewhere in the Old Testament. Could it be Psalm 23, the Lord is my shepherd? And so this imagery goes along with that, that Yahweh, who is our Lord, or the Lord of Israel in the original context, like a shepherd, he will feed his flock with his arm, he will gather the lambs, and in his bosom, he will lift them up, the young, and he will lead them. And so I'm not sure if Isaiah wants us to think of going back, leading them back to Jerusalem, or whether once they're there, they will be shepherded. So verse 12, who measured with his hand the waters and the heavens, the heavens and the waters? Of course, in the Jewish worldview, you have the waters on which the land rests, and of course the skies above. Heavens here, you shouldn't think of heaven the way we think of heaven. You should think of the heavens as in the skies, the waters in the skies. Who measured them? Who has measured with his hand? So God's hand is so, now of course this is a metaphor, it's anthropomorphism, but God's hand is so big that he can use them to measure the entirety of the earth. Of course, I would now say God can use his hand to measure the entirety of the galaxy and of the universes. But this is as big, as the author of this section of Isaiah or Isaiah, the most that their brain can handle is the advance of the earth as they understand it. And so they use the biggest imagery that he can use. God reveals himself in the biggest imagery that they can understand, that he can measure in the hollow of his hand, the water, the skies and the waters, with the span. He measured and he calculated with a measure the dust of the earth, and he weighed it in scales the mountain. So you have this picture of a gigantic, gigantic being who can put the mountains, take the tallest mountain. Now, I'm in Indiana. There aren't any mountains around here. You know, I've been to Wales and I've been to Scotland. I'm sure there are somebody listening to this at some point has probably been to the Himalayas. I've not been to the Himalayas. I think the Schmierzys were there recently, Jess Schmierzy. But when I was in Wales, driving through the mountains, or in Scotland, those were the biggest mountains I had ever seen. I mean, you drive through the Rockies, but this was a whole different scale than I'd ever observed. You think of how big God, think of God as this humongous colossus, who can take, Mount Ararat, or Mount Everest, and put it on his scales and weigh it, because that's how great and how grand God is. He can weigh the hills on a balance. Of course, Isaiah, or the author of this section, would not have had any experience with mountains that big, probably, as far as I know. Verse 13, this is another one. Who has directed the Spirit of Yahweh? Or what man has taught him as his counselor? Now, this, of course, is used in the New Testament in 1 Corinthians. Paul quotes this here. With whom did he take counsel, and who instructed him and taught him in the way of mishpat, in the way of judgment, of justice, and taught him knowledge? Who taught God knowledge? Who took him to school? Who schooled the Lord and in the way of understanding showed him? Who? Nobody. Because nobody understands the universe as God does. Verse 15, behold, the nations are as a drop in the bucket. You wonder where that expression came from? Oh, that's just a drop in the bucket. The nations, all of the inhabited world is like a drop, in the bucket of God. He is so great. As dust on the scales are counted. Look, behold, the isles, which is like the farthest that they could imagine. I mean, the United States would be the Isles, although they didn't know it at the time. You know, go as far as you can go to where you're just seeing islands. You know, look at the Isles. He lifts them up as a teeny tiny little thing. So this is great, great imagery of God, isn't it? How great is our God? How wonderful. How big and wide his vast domain. To try to tell, these lips can only start. He's big enough to fill this mighty universe, yet small enough to live within my heart. Anyway, what a great passage this is. Of course, all of Scripture is great. This is just incredibly stirring, talking about the greatness of God. And of course, this is the God that is bringing Israel, Judah, back from their captivity in Babylon, bringing them back to Judea, bringing them back to Jerusalem. And of course, let me go ahead and say the New Testament bit, since I'll probably move on Friday, that Paul uses this passage here, verse 14. If I remember correctly the passage, I think it's in 1 Corinthians 3, 2 and 3. Basically, what Paul is saying is that there is a certain kind of worldly wisdom, that those who don't think like God thinks, They look at the way certain Christians think, and they think, well, that's stupid. You know, well, that doesn't make any sense at all. And what Paul says, there is wisdom. There is wisdom, Christian thinking. There is a wisdom to Christian thinking, but it's not the way the world thinks. The things that the world thinks, those aren't the things that the Holy Spirit thinks. We have, Paul says, the Holy Spirit inside of us. And when you have the Holy Spirit inside of you, you have God's wisdom, which is different from the wisdom of the world. And here, Paul quotes this, who instructs the Lord? Who can teach the Lord? Well, guess what? We've got the Spirit of the Lord inside of us, giving us, we've got an insider information on what the sovereign creator of the world thinks. Well, great passage. I'll stop there. And Lord willing, on Friday, we will go on from verse 16 in Isaiah chapter 40.